Sundays, 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. from June to September at Dr. Walter Hardy Park. It's homegrown produce and handmade goods. And our own page, wherever you are, page.
I don't think she's staying.
She's going to be explaining some of her stuff. So, if you want to look at this, you can.
And
I'm going to go over there because I'm looking for green tomatoes. They have green tomatoes in the stores for about 1 week, you know, depending on where you're at. And if you don't get them then, you don't hardly get them. So I'm going to be going down to the Walter Hardy Park to get me some green tomatoes if I could find them. Art show, there seems to be some excitement around the idea of an art show. And the more people I talk to, the more ideas we're generating. There's just all kinds of folks who are focused on art. I think in the Episcopal Church, and hopefully we'll find folks who are focused on art here in this community. And it'll be a good way to show the community that we really do respect it. We expect good things to come from this community. And if we don't encourage people to show their artwork, they may never get a chance to do it. So we're going to be talking more about that. We'll be having folks that we know doing some small workshops to show how they do things so that we can have maybe more than one person here at the church while we're displaying art, doing other things, you know? Who's the lady who did the jewelry? Jeannie, is that right?
Jeannie.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, at the cafe. Jeannie, what was the name? She's on my Facebook, friends. Yeah. I can find her again. Just didn't tell you, started with a V.
So I think the more that we talk about this, the more ideas we're going to generate. And so we'll begin a serious discussion about it and the timing, because we want to do it the right way, obviously. And I really want to try to encourage the kids to submit art. It doesn't matter what it is. As long as you're willing to put it up so people can see it, that's art. As far as I'm concerned. So that's what we're going to be doing. Any other announcements that I can? Yeah.
First Sunday means that loose offering today or a check written that is memoed, Deacon's discretionary fund, put it in the brown box. In what are you saying, John Mayo?
Envelope.
There are envelopes there. You can indicate whether it's to go to your pledge or to the Deacon's Discretionary Fund. We live in an area of need, and this gives our deacons some way of meeting some of that need.
I have some brochures for the men's retreat. That's going to be in August. It's the annual Episcopal men's retreat down in Solani. If you're interested, come by the office and grab a brochure.
Just
We might want to see if we can get a contingent of guys to go.
Yeah.
It's not like we don't have men in here. Trish, can I announce this? Okay. Trish's operation is on August 1st at UT Hospital. I imagine I will be there. I'm usually there anyway, whether I like it or not. So keep that in mind. So support her with prayer. Thanks, Trish. Let's do this.
Thank you.
Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God, forever and ever. Amen.
Together saying, Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
To you, the throne of the heavens.
As the eyes of servants look to the hand of their
shows us his mercy.
Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy.
For we have had more than enough of contempt.
Too much of the scorn of the indolent, rich.
Abjuration of the proud.
Second reading is from 2 Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up in the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. Was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelation. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The sequence is in your levitation. We'll lift every voice and sing, and it's number 194. Number 194.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus came to his hometown and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And he took offense at them. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at his unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You might be a preacher if you'd rather negotiate with terrorists than the church treasury. The church picnic is no picnic. You've been tempted to take up an offering at a family reunion. You might be a preacher if you've ever wanted to give the sound tech some feedback of your own. You might be a preacher if you ever wanted to lay hands on a deacon and you weren't thinking of praying for him. Interesting turn of phrase. Yeah. You know, it was interesting putting together a sermon for this Sunday because there are many things that were said in the passages, and many really famous quotes that I think lead us to find our humanity in good old Paul. Paul, what a complex guy. He was, I'm not sure I could have gone down to the local bar and had a beer with Paul. I don't know if I could have done that. Because he was really pretty, at least initially, until he had a chance, I think, to be around Christians in relationships. I don't think he really knew what to think about all this Christ stuff.
you know?
Because he was just a guy, just a man. But he was a powerful man. He was a Pharisee. And it's interesting because in this particular set of verses, there are a lot of things that Paul says, and one of them that he talks about is a thorn in the flesh. Now, there's been all kinds of debate about what he meant by that. And I'll leave it up to you to sort out for yourself what it means, but I want you to think about it. This is a teaching tool. Whether we plan it or not, if we don't pay attention, it will really teach us. These are thorns. I mean, if Paul was talking about a thorn in his flesh, well, if these are the kind of thorns that they were used to in Israel, you must have had a serious situation, or at least one that hurt him enough that he needed to ask God's help for that. And so, you know, you get this feeling of ego from Paul a good part of the time. And yet then there are those moments when Paul is bearing himself to us, whether we really realize it or not. And I find that when I read this, there was something about the moment, about the prayers, about the meditation that I did. I ended up feeling really connected to Paul because he was talking about his shortcomings. And I can see in Paul the tension around needing to do the right thing. And in his great degree of faith, he still appears confused to me in this passage about who he is. There's so much about him as a human being that we don't really know. It's about legend. But here when he's talking about his shortcomings, he says, "Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong." You know, I hated those kind of sentences in graduate school. You know, it's like a double entendre. You know, yeah, you're this, but now you're really this. But I know what he meant. I know what he meant. He's talking about his own confusion. And he's talking about having found the peace in Jesus Christ that helps him to understand even those conversations that he has in his head. Can't ever go home again, though. Especially if you're a prophet. Can't go home. I mean, you can go home physically, but are you ever really home again? Think about the time when you left home. Remember that? Might not have been a great time for you. But did you ever go back to where you were born and raised to visit? I did. And to see if things had changed. And you know what? They changed. They really did. My life, I think, was really, really chaotic. But Christ also needed to make a point about faith, I believe. When Christ was talking about only being able to heal some folks, to me, the message he was sending was that faith was absent from a lot of folks, but not the ones who he healed. That faith is critical in terms of asking something in prayer and then waiting for an answer. And I don't think it matters a lot about how much faith you have. Christ sent the disciples out, and that's also talked about here in the verses, to do what would become their job, and some would die for it. What is your job? What is our job? I know I keep coming back to this when I preach. Our job is to carry the message of Christ's love to people in this community who don't get a chance to hear. And to make this church a beacon to the African American community, that people can come here and know they'll be accepted and loved without question, no matter who they are. Because we come to church because we believe in all of this. Otherwise, it would be a big mess. If we didn't have just a little bit of faith to keep our spirits running, how many of you pray all day long? You know what? I found that as I've gotten older, I spend more time in conversation with God. Maybe it's because I have more time now that I'm retired, but I don't think so. Because I was in conversations with God all day before I ever retired. Over a period of years, it just became a habit. And along with that, I find myself laughing at myself even more and more. So what is this thing that we call old age that makes us so much more pliable in terms of opening our minds? It's because we want to love, and we don't like it if we can't love, and that's one of the dilemmas that Paul struggled with and found an answer to. How many of you watch TV and watch the news and find yourself saying, I hate that man? Well, I do. And then I catch myself. I don't actually say it. That would be a good Christian thing to do. But it's how I feel. And I'm sad about that because I wish I could feel another way. Those are the dilemmas that Paul was talking about. Christ, faith, all these things we hear every Sunday, whether it's me preaching or someone else. You ever hear, we talked about shaking the dust off the feet when we leave a place where we're not welcome. You know who came up with that? Wasn't somebody in the Bible, it was Thomas Wolfe. Thomas Wolfe. He said, you could never go home again, but he also was able to state the obvious problem with anything that we try to do that we've left behind. We're supposed to move forward if we can. A hot day. And I'm probably going to go down and get me some green tomatoes, and then I'm going to go home. But every time I go home from here, I'm happy when I leave. Not because I'm leaving. I'm happy because I've been here. I'm happy because folks are warm, tender, they care. And even in this heat, here you are. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.
Gracious God, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. May we also be eager to hear what you ask of us.
In confidence and trust, we pray for the church. God of power and might, enliven the church for her mission.
That we may be salt of the earth and light to the world.
Breathe fresh life into your people.
Give us power to reveal Christ in word and action.
May we be mindful of the things we say and do.
We pray for the world. God, creator of all, lead us and every people into the ways of justice and peace.
That we may respect one another in freedom and truth.
Awaken in us a sense of wonder for the earth and all that is in it.
Teach us to care creatively for its resources.
May we remember that we are part of one earth family.
Remember global warming.
Remember we are accountable. We pray for the community. God of truth, inspire with your wisdom those whose decisions affect the lives of others.
That all may act with integrity and courage.
As leaders that work for peace.
Give grace to all whose lives are linked with ours.
May we serve Christ and one another and love as he loves.
All family and friends.
May we see Christ in the people we do not like. We pray for those in need. God of hope, comfort and restore all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit.
May the name of the healing power of your love.
For Lacey, Patrice, Marie, Chris, Mary, Marsha, those grants for all flowers, Anisha, Brandon, Lisa, John, Rufus. Make us willing agents of your compassion.
Strengthen us as we share in making people whole.
We pray for those who have died, remembering both those who have died in the faith of life, and faith of life everlasting, and those whose faith is known to you alone.
Father, into your hands we commend them.
Give comfort to those who mourn.
Bring peace in their time of loss.
We praise you for all your saints. God of light and joy, teach and encourage us also.
May we too trust in your love, serve your purpose, and praise your name. Christ our Lord. Amen.
God has promised forgiveness to all who truly repent. Let us turn to Christ in faith and receive God's forgiveness. See, and as
I get up, she goes to the next window and texts again. Okay, I'm coming. Isn't that how God deals with us? And so I go outside. Immediately, she takes off for her coop. And I'm supposed to follow. And I do. She had gotten out of her coop somehow and couldn't get back in. And her people weren't home. So she came and knocked on my window to let her in. And then there was another chicken there, too, who had gotten out and couldn't get back in. So I called the people and said, we're in Kingston. Oh, okay. Let them in the gate. So I open the gate and she goes in, but the other one had gone around the fence. So I go around to get the chicken, herd her back. Or chicken herder. She doesn't go. I picked her up, put her over the fence, back in. Well, I'll be darned if that's not what God does with us. I mean, even when we can't find our way back to the gate, somehow God picks us up and puts us back in. And if that's praying all day, I guess maybe sometimes.
That is prayer.
It's always more and more.
Yeah, and I love that story so much. I just have to tell everybody.
I'm so glad. Thank you. Yeah. And the chicken, thank you.
Chicken whisperer.
Yeah,
chicken whisperer. Yeah. The walk in love. Gave himself for us in offering and a sad sacrifice.
The heaven offertory is in Lift Every Voice and Sing. Let us sing the minutes number 181.
Thank you. And of thine own have we given thee.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us the fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. The unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honored.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. John, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation.
Six.
Thank you.